Neil Young is a world-renowned musician who started his career way back in the 60s, and he's still going strong today. But despite his longevity, much of his life has remained in the dark to the public at large. Neil Young's not the only famous individual in his family. He was born on November 12, 1945, in Toronto, Canada, to Edna and Scott Young, the latter of whom was one of the most distinguished sports journalists in Canadian history. He started his journalism career with the Winnipeg Free Press before moving on to the Canadian Press, where he worked from 1942 to 1943 as a war correspondent in London during World War II. He then went on to serve in the Royal Canadian Naval Volunteer Reserves for the rest of the war. After going on to spend 3 years as the assistant editor at Maclean's magazine, he spent the next 3 decades as a popular sports journalist, columnist, and commentator for the Toronto Globe and Mail, the Toronto Telegram, and the CBC. Scott Young was also a successful author and historian, as he published a number of nonfiction books, short stories, and novels, including Neil and Me, a 1984 biography about his son. He also gave Neil his first musical instrument, a ukulele. In 1988, Scott Young was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame as a journalist. He died in June 2005 at the age of 87. Neil Young's music career has taken him through many different genres, from soft folk and country to blues and grunge rock. One genre he's not usually associated with is R&B, but in fact, he was actually once a member of an R&B group, the Mina Birds, early in his career. That group was fronted by a young Rick James, and they were on their way to being signed by the legendary Motown Records. Unfortunately, James was on the run from the law, as he was in Canada to avoid being drafted into the United States Navy. With a string of multiple low-level convictions to his name and not wanting to fight in the Vietnam War, James fled north. The Mina Birds released 2 singles that caught the attention of Motown, which gave the group a deal and a cash advance. Alas, the money disappeared when their manager got a hold of it, so the band fired him. But in retaliation, he informed the authorities and Motown of James's status. James was soon taken into custody by the Navy. Motown cut ties, and the group was over. Young later spoke with Mojo magazine about his musical direction following the breakup. As he noted, "I moved instead towards acoustic music and immediately became very introspective and musically inward. That's the beginning of that whole side of my music." The 1969 Woodstock Music Festival has a reputation as the apex of the counterculture movement of the era. Among the lineup was one of Neil Young's bands, Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young. CSNY was still in their infancy when they played Woodstock. Each member had been successful in previous bands, but Woodstock was just the second time they played together as a group for any audience. Nevertheless, their set went off without a hitch during the early morning hours of Monday, August 18th. But despite that success, Young doesn't make any kind of appearance during the performance. Even his name is redacted when the band is introduced. He told Howard Stern that he was annoyed that the cameramen were up in his face while he was performing, rather than shooting from a distance.
"They didn't have to be right there. That was stupid. They didn't have to be on the stage. They're cameras. Hello?"
Ironically enough, CSNY would go on to cover Joni Mitchell's song about the festival, also called Woodstock, on their 1970 album, Deja Vu. Young's face at Woodstock was eventually seen in a new documentary about the festival that was released in 2019. Many songwriters have drawn inspiration from their own lives, and Neil Young is no exception. But one of his most well-known songs, The Needle and the Damage Done, from the 1972 album Harvest, has a particularly dark origin story. It's about Danny Whitten, a former friend and bandmate of Young's. Whitten was an original member of Crazy Horse, which would eventually become Young's backing band. But by the beginning of the 70s, Whitten had become heavily addicted to heroin, which persisted despite multiple interventions. Young ultimately fired Whitten after a bad session during which he couldn't even hold his guitar. He gave his friend $50 for rehab and a plane ticket back to Los Angeles. In 1972, Whitten would fatally overdose on alcohol and Valium shortly after reaching LA. Young later spoke of his friend's death by confessing, "I felt responsible, but really there was nothing I could do. I mean, he was responsible, but I thought I was for a long time. Danny just wasn't happy. It just all came down on him. He was engulfed by this drug. That was too bad, because Danny had a lot to give." Young has written a number of protest songs influenced by his political leanings. One of the most famous, Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young's Ohio, was inspired by a real-life tragedy. On May 4, 1970, National Guardsmen fired live ammunition into a crowd of anti-war protesters on the campus of Kent State University. A few days later, David Crosby handed Young a copy of Life magazine that featured an image of the gruesome aftermath. Young then disappeared for a few hours into the woods and returned with the lyrics written and studio time booked. Despite being censored by many stations for its political lyrics, Ohio became a top 20 hit and an anti-war anthem.
I had to do this song. I don't mean it to be a downer, but one of my songs, what can I tell you?
Young's protest music spans decades. His 1989 hit, Rockin' in the Free World, was a harsh critique of the George H.W. Bush administration and rising political tensions in the Middle East and Eastern Europe. Young also later showed his disdain for the second Bush president when in 2006 he released the album Living with War, which made clear his thoughts about George W. Bush and the War on Terror. Neil Young has had a complicated relationship with his bandmates over the years. His desire to be a solo artist led to his split with Buffalo Springfield, but it also accidentally created the supergroup Crosby, Stills, and Nash. When Young refused to perform at the Monterey Pop Festival with Buffalo Springfield, Stephen Stills asked David Crosby to fill in, and the two of them hit it off. They were then introduced to Graham Nash, and they formed a trio. After their first album in 1969, Atlantic Records president Emet Ertegun pushed them to add Young to the band. Following an album and two tours as a member of Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, Young left to continue his solo career in 1970. 3 years later, Young called Nash and Crosby to join him on a tour, and soon enough, all four men were together again. But when the band decided to make a new album, Young disappeared. A year later, Young called Stills, desiring to work on a CSNY album, but Nash and Crosby were unable to join due to contractual reasons. Despite Crosby and Nash recording vocals, Young and Stills cut their contributions, creating a Stills and Young duo album and angering their old bandmates. And like clockwork, while touring, Young decided to leave, forcing Stills to finish the tour alone. Neil Young and Lynyrd Skynyrd both reached the peaks of their popularity in the 1970s. They also had a publicly antagonistic relationship towards each other. Two of Young's most popular songs, Southern Man and Alabama, both took aim at racism in the American South. These tunes caught the ear of Ronnie Van Zant, Skynyrd's lead singer and songwriter. He was a fan of Young's, but he felt that his songs painted the South with too broad a brush. His response was Sweet Home Alabama, which called out Young by name. Despite what seemed to be evidence of a feud, in reality, these two acts were apparently on good terms with each other. Van Zant, who passed away in a plane crash in 1977, reportedly wrote his response as a joke, and Young had even penned the song Powderfinger for Skynyrd to record, and the surviving members of Skynyrd have claimed that there was no feud. Back when Neil Young was a teenage traveling musician, the Beatles made their way to the United States and launched the musical counterculture of the 60s. In many ways, the Fab Four paved the way for Young and plenty of others. At the same time, two Beatles, John Lennon and George Harrison, were very critical of Young and his music. In a 1980 Playboy interview, Lennon took exception with what he believed was the message in Young's 1977 song, Hey Hey My My Into the Black. Lennon said, "I hate it. It's better to fade away like an old soldier than to burn out." If he was talking about burning out like Sid Vicious, forget it. I don't appreciate the worship of dead Sid Vicious, or of dead James Dean, or dead John Wayne. No, thank you. I'll take the living and the healthy. Lennon died 3 months after the interview. Young responded to the criticism 2 years later, as he explained that he was referring to the spirit of rock and roll and not specific individuals. Lennon's criticism can be chalked up to mixed messages, but it's a little more clear-cut when it comes to what George Harrison had to say. During a studio session in 1992, Harrison told singer-songwriter Bob Geldof, "I'm not a Neil Young fan." And then, when Geldof began to wax poetic about Young's guitar playing, Harrison insisted, "I hate it. Yeah, I can't stand it." It's hard to argue with the Beatle, although millions of Neil Young fans probably would. Neil Young has never been shy about sharing his political opinions. He's also spent a lot of time on the front lines of many social movements, from his teen years to today. For example, in 1985, he organized the benefit concert, Farm Aid, along with John Mellencamp and Willie Nelson. Then, in 2020, Young officially became a citizen of the United States. and he used the movement to lambaste President Donald Trump. During Trump's 2016 presidential campaign, he had played Young's Rockin in the Free World, despite the song being a critique of the first Bush administration. Young demanded that Trump not use his song, and after becoming a citizen, he penned an open letter with the first line declaring, "You are a disgrace to my country." Young has also been critical of the other side of the aisle. In 2016, he called on then-President Barack Obama to step in during the Dakota Access Pipeline protests at the Standing Rock Indian Reservation.
The entire world needs a reset.
Early in his life, Neil Young suffered from various health issues. At the age of 6, he was unable to walk for a time because of the effects of type 1 diabetes, epilepsy, and polio. He would recover, but these issues would follow him for the rest of his life. And he's not the only in his family with health troubles. Both of his sons, Zeke and Ben, suffer from severe cases of cerebral palsy. Ben was unable to attend area schools because they weren't equipped to handle his condition. So in 1986, Neil and his wife at the time, Peggy, founded the Bridge School to help kids like Ben.
Ben has taught me that you never give up. You can't say, this is too hard. It can't be too hard.
Young met Peggy back in 1974, and they got married in 1978, which was Young's second marriage. They were together for decades, but they ultimately divorced in 2014, and Peggy passed away from cancer on New Year's Day 2019. After the divorce, Young began a relationship with actress Daryl Hannah, and they got married in secret in 2018. They revealed their relationship status to the world when Young referred to Hannah as his wife in a social media post supporting gun control legislation. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more Grunge videos about your favorite musicians are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.